My name is Rachel Roffey. I created this show because I wanted to help you see that if you have a choice, you can choose a better life. If you're listening to this podcast, you're in a pretty fortunate position. You have free will, ability to connect to the internet, and access to all kinds of new education. This podcast is meant to help you make the most of your good fortune. We talk with all kinds of people here from all walks of life because I want you to see that no matter what your situation, there's always a way to create a life that you're proud of. Hello. So welcome to today's show. And today's show is going to be a little bit different from the type of podcast that I normally do. It's actually because I've had two people recently in one day ask me to create today's show. And if you've listened to my other podcasts, you know that I really love to create podcasts based on what you are asking for. If you have any kind of topic request or anything you think that I could talk about that will help you with, you know, your life, your business, please let me know, because it's really important to me to make sure that whatever I'm creating is as beneficial as possible. So what we're going to talk about today is what my path was of becoming, I guess, successful. Successful is the word they used. You know, it's so interesting for me to hear the word successful. It's just, you know, I guess it means so many different things to so many different people, that word. I'm just, I think, a bit hard on myself. So it's just weird to say successful. But, you know, I do feel proud of some things that I've accomplished. And so I guess I'll just share more coming from that vantage point of the things that I'm proud of. I'm going to just go, I'll give you a very quick overview of what I was doing before I started the marketing, and then I'll just go into what happened since then. I'm not exactly sure why people asked for this, but I'm hoping that the benefit of it is maybe you'll get inspired or get some action steps. I'll go through different things that I wish I would have known back then, kind of thing, so you can hopefully benefit from that. And that's that. So today's episode is sponsored by podcastprodigy.com, and that is my course on podcasting. So if you are interested in creating your own business, or you have your own business and you just like to get in front of more people, I mean, I love podcasting. I think it's such a great way to grow your audience and get in front of new people. Okay, so let's get into it. I actually had another podcast I published, I think back in September or something, and it was a little bit more vulnerable about just what my childhood was. And we're not going to get super into childhood and stuff. In today's show, it's going to be more of a kind of what my career progression has been. But I did just want to mention, you know, my childhood, if you listen to that podcast, you know it was a bit rough. You know that it wasn't like I was some kind of golden child or something. I would say my school's grades were a little bit probably above average until I moved to Pennsylvania from New York, and then they were average, and I just was no longer excited by school. I didn't really apply to anywhere for college. I was pretty demotivated, so I did end up going to college, but I went to community college my first 2 years, and then I ended up finishing up my degree while I was working full-time. So when I was 16, I started working at Walmart. I was a cashier over at Walmart, and it was just like the lowest kind of pay grade there was. I would just walk over after school, and I was a cashier. And then I ended up working my way up to management. So by the time I left there, I had been a cashier, a customer service manager, human resources manager, and then an assistant manager. And then after that, I went over to Target. And so at Target, I was in charge of clothing department. So the clothing departments there were worth like a couple million dollars. I was at one of the busiest Targets. And so I was in charge of a bunch of different department managers. So people who were in charge of like ladies' clothing, men's clothing, children's shoes, lingerie, different things. And then all the people who worked for them. So I was covering all of that and really directly responsible for over a couple million dollars worth of products. And then, you know, there'd be times where I would be in charge of the store, which would mean I'd be in charge of like a multi-million dollar store, and then all the people in there. So it could be like hundreds of people at a time. And when I was over at Target, it was crazy. I mean, the other managers and I've mentioned this before on other episodes. I don't know on other episodes, but definitely when people have interviewed me, we would just sit around and talk about how much we hated our lives, the other managers and I. We were called executives. And it was just one of these things where when I was there, I was 23 years old. I was making, I remember, $55,100 a year. thought, wow, like I'm making a lot of money. I didn't think as a 23-year-old I'd be able to make more money anywhere else. And so I just kept doing it. And I was worried in the future that I wouldn't be able to have kids, I wouldn't be able to raise a family, because how it was I was working like full time there, 60 to 80 hours a week. I was going to school full time, and just my work ethic is pretty, like I would do these 36-hour shifts. I would do whatever it took to get what I needed to get done. And actually, when I ended up quitting that job, they hired two people to replace me. It was just a crazy job. With the Target, I just felt like I couldn't leave until I found another way to make the money that I was making, because I was really spending above my means. And so even though I kept getting these different like raises, I was still living at home when I was 23, because I just kept spending. I couldn't even afford an apartment. So all throughout this time, when I was working at Walmart, when I was working at Target, I started doing a little bit of selling random things on the side. So for a while, I was an eBay power seller, and I was selling different items. One thing that I was doing that I loved was I would go to thrift stores and consignment shops, and I would find different pieces of clothing. It was high end, but people didn't know, and then I would go and flip it on eBay. So I would just, like, I remember I had a Burberry trench coat once, and I bought it for, I don't know, $15, and then I ended up selling it for $800. And I had lots of little things like that, and it was really fun. So I was earning income that way, but it wasn't really a very stable thing. It wasn't like I could go and quit my job or something. I would always try these little things, and I remember one time I was looking on Craigslist and I saw one of these ebooks, and it was like, make $1 million a minute in your underwear while you're sleeping, blah blah blah. And so I bought the ebook, and basically it just said, if you promote this ebook, then you'll make an affiliate commission, so you'll get a cut every time you sell the book. So it wasn't like an MLM or something, but it was basically, if I have a special link that advertises this ebook, and this was back in 2006, by the way, it's not something I would have done now at all, but back then I was like, okay, I didn't really get to the I guess lack of value nature of what this was. I was just kind of dabbling, and I tried selling the ebook, and I was basically just on Craigslist promoting it, and it did amazingly. Again, like, not something I'm proud of right now. Like, I would never do it now, not in a million years. But back in 2006, when I was just miserable in my job, I was trying this, I basically would post an ad for this ebook. So other people would buy it. Let's say it was $20. I would get $10 every time it was sold. And I was making between $500 to $800 a day, my very first day, for several months. When I realized that I could actually make money online, I got up the gumption to quit my job, and that was back in June 2006. And then since June 2006, I've been full-time marketing. I've done all kinds of different business models from then, and I always still cringe whenever I talk about this whole Craigslist thing and promoting that book, because I mean, it did actually have a little bit of information on just different ways to promote products, how you can become an affiliate, but it really wasn't loaded with value for sure. But whatever, I guess I'll just have to kind of forgive myself for it. So after that, I tried different things. So one thing was, shortly after, I found out about, there was this thing called the 30-day challenge. And basically, at the time, it was Frank Kern and Ed Dale, and they would teach you for free how to earn money online by selling information products. And so I tried selling information products, which were basically just like PDFs of knowledge that people could buy. And it was either like for things that maybe I was an expert on, or things where I just did a ton of research, and so people would buy for the convenience, all different types of things. So back then I was in all kinds of niches. So I had baby shower favors was one of my niches, where I had a listing of different baby shower favors that you could do that are inexpensive and fun to make, would go over well, that kind of thing. There was one where I had a list of resources so that could help you with your marketing. So there were all kinds of different things, and they really had varying success. So the baby shower favors did decently. My marketing stuff, I remember my first marketing offer, I had a product, I priced it $97, and I sold 13 copies my first day. So I just kept going with it. It was awesome. But the thing with that was, it was very up and down. My income was just kind of like feast and famine, and I didn't really know all the time. It was very, well, I mean, when I was launching something, when I was launching a new product, it was great. But if I wasn't, then I didn't have that much money. So While I was trying to navigate that up and down income, I did some other things, like a lot of service-based things. I mean, I would do like ghostwriting, so I would write for other people, I would get paid, and then they would sell things. They would put their name on it, but I would actually come up with the content. And then I also did copywriting. So if you ever go on a like a website and you see a bunch of text basically selling a product, I did that. I would help people sell their product via the written word. And when I started the copywriting, my first sales letter is what they're called. I charged $100 for it. And then I ended up working my way up pretty quickly to, by the time I kind of retired from copywriting, I was making about $5,000 per letter. And I love services. I think if you're starting out and you're wanting to create consistent income or even fast income, having some kind of a service. So maybe it's writing for people, maybe it's doing graphics, virtual assistant work, whatever it is, that's kind of your fastest path to cash, I think. And you can do that while you're building up more sustainable income sources. That was back then, and then since then, I've tried all different types of things. So when I was in different niches, I was starting to create information products based on things that I could teach about. So I had lost 100 pounds, and so one of the products I created was a membership site helping people learn how I lost the weight. And so people would pay $20 a month, and they would get access to a forum. At the time, forums were still really popular. They would have calorie calculators so they could go through and type in what they were eating. It would compute their calories and they would be able to talk with different experts. So I had nutritionists in there and we had workout playlists and blogs and all this kind of thing. And that did really well. And then in 2008, I sold it. I sold it for $50,000. At the time, I was so excited. And I ended up going to Rio de Janeiro after that for 3 months and just kind of figured out what I wanted to do next. So while I was in Rio de Janeiro, I was kind of bored. I got there really excited and I ended up not liking Portuguese and I loved the beaches, but I was living with a friend, but while he was working, I would just go to the beach. And so I started learning all about meditation. And so after that, I had a product on meditation. So basically, I had been searching for guided meditations while I was learning about this because I couldn't get my mind focused enough when I was trying to meditate. It was just going all over the place. And I found that I loved the guided meditations that would kind of like people would be talking in these meditations and help my mind go to wherever I wanted to go. So I was looking for them. And at the time, back in 2008, there really wasn't that much online. So I hired somebody to make me a whole bunch of different guided meditations, which I then sold. I had a book written, and then I was selling that as well. And so I did that. I have all kinds of random kind of niche products and niche sites where I would just get into markets and then it looked like I could provide some value and I'd sell products. I had an outsourcing company at one point, so I had different assistants who were working with me when I was in my niche markets. And one day, one of them wrote to me, and she said basically she had been working a second job with another company, and everyone at that other company, I think there was like, I don't remember now, maybe 100 other people who got laid off, and basically the owner of that company had said, you know, you're all basically out of a job as of tomorrow. He gave them no warning, no severance pay, no anything. And what they were doing was just all kinds of work to help marketers online. So they would do things like write blog entries and search engine optimize sites and make videos and all different types of things. So me trying to be a hero, I tried to help them all find jobs, which ended up being me creating an outsourcing company where basically people would pay a monthly fee, like so other customers would pay a monthly fee and they would get access to all these people who lost their jobs. And it was this big kind of convoluted mess where it ended up just being really stressful. Ugh, it was just such a mess. I remember it, like I was doing kind of journaling on different years in my life and high points in each part of my life. And 2010, when I had that outsourcing company, was definitely like there were not very many high points. I was stressed out all the time. I guess that's kind of a condensed version of it. But basically, by the time I sold it, I was trying to sell it for a dollar. It was making like between $60,000 and $80,000 a month, I think, at the time when I sold it. But I just hated it. I was trying to sell it for a dollar. Just get it away from me. It was like one of these things that was born out of me trying to save everybody. And it was really tough because by the time we sold it, we had 120 different contracted employees. And we had hundreds and hundreds of customers. We got 125 clients our very first week. And so trying to manage all these different client expectations and all these contractors, and I had an operations manager and everything, but I just hated it. So I sold that back in 2010. Then from there, I mean, I've done so many different things. So I had a bunch of Kindle books. So if you've heard my bio ever and say about how I have 40 different books now, that's probably actually closer to 50 at this point. But the first book, so basically, I had a business partner back, I think, in like 2010 to 2012 or so. And I had another one when I was doing the copywriting. But when I had my business partner in 2010, we had talked about how we were in different niches. He was in stress, I was in meditation, and how we weren't maximizing those niches as much as possible. So we ended up deciding to have a little bit of a contest with each other. And we figured whoever would make more money with their niche, so if he would make more money in stress or I would make more money in meditation, the winner would get a $1,000 gift card to Amazon from the other person. And so I was just trying anything I could do to win and make more money with my meditation site. And so one of the things I did was I just threw up a book on Kindle to see how it would go. I had never tried Kindle. I didn't know, but I knew I had a really good book. So anyway, that did really well really quickly. It ended up making, by the second month, it was making $3,000 a month from that one book. And so it's harder to make like great money in Kindle now, but at the time, you know, it was so great. So I ended up just making more and more books, and I had a whole outsourcing assembly line, and I was doing that for a while. So that was great. What else? I mean, I've done so many different things. I've had other membership sites. I do affiliate marketing. So while I was creating my information products, I would also build up a list at the same time. So people who bought my products, I would put them on an email list, and so I would let them know when I created more products or when I found other products that I felt that would be helpful for them, and I got a commission from those, and I still do that. So that's becoming an affiliate, and I do that still, and it's a great way to earn more revenue and support great products. And now I'm still doing a lot of those information products, and I have this podcast. As you know, I think podcasting is such an awesome tool for business owners, and it's just such a great way to get in front of new people. So I love that. And then I just now really focus a lot on creating passive income streams. So I have the podcast, if you haven't listened to it yet, on three different ways that I earn $1,000 a month. At least $1,000 a month, so three different streams. And it's really all about, for me now, like just creating consistent revenue. So not having the kind of feast or famine things. So I said that I would tell you kind of what my best takeaways are from this whole thing, and from just my experience since 2006. At the time I'm creating this, it's now March 2015. So I've been doing it for almost, oh my gosh, almost 9 years now. That's crazy. I think the best takeaways are, number one, like I said, services are really good for earning quick income. And then when you're building other things, I think focus on long-term income, long-term results. So not like what are the short-term wins, because short-term goes away really quickly, but put your attention into things that will really get you results for a long time to come. So that could be creating websites that are membership-based, so you get paid every single month, or it could be things that you'll get paid out for every single month, maybe products that you can sell every month in and out. So that for sure. Because consistent long term really helps you avoid that feast or famine. So if you're creating something, you may as well create something that's going to be beneficial for you for a long time to come and save yourself stress later on. Because I do think that when you're first launching a business, you need to hustle really hard. I mean, even now I'm still like, I have periods of like super hustle. So if you're going to spend all that time hustling, you may as well put it into projects that are going to pay you back over and over and over, and not just kind of short-term things like launches that you then like you launch once and then you forget about, things like that. So anyway, that ended up becoming a lot longer than I anticipated, but that's a bit of my path. So if you have any questions on this, or you want me to go into more detail on any of this, please let me know. Twitter, Facebook, my blog, whatever, rachelrafay.com, or you can email me at rachelreports@gmail.com. Just let me know. I really want to be making more podcasts that I know are going to benefit you. Thank you for listening. And today's show has been sponsored by podcastprodigy.com. And I think podcasting is a great way to create long-term results because people listen to podcasts, and if they like what you have, then they go and they listen to all your other old shows too. And so it's a great way to get long-term results and to do work once and have it pay back over and over and over. So that's one of the reasons I'm so into it now. All right, have a great day, and I'll talk to you soon. Thank you so much for listening to A Better Life. You can find all show notes for this episode at rachelrofe.com. If you enjoyed this episode, subscribe so you can automatically get access to all new shows. Let's also connect. Just go onto Twitter, Facebook, or Instagram /Rachel Rofe, and we can talk there. The opinions of all guests here are their own, and I'm not necessarily endorsing any of them. I do want to give you perspective, though. And always remember, if you have a choice, choose a better life.